Got an email. It's been about a week or so. John Lucas sent me an email. John D. Lucas wrote a book. Haven't they suffered enough? An unbelievable career in sports PR and television, paperback on the great, the late great, Beano Cook, who was a major staple of college football coverage for the longest of times. And John now joins us on Sikkim 365 Radio, Paul Catalina, Craig Smoke, and David Smoke as well. John, I think I read in parts of the book that you actually, he was prepping you to write this at some point back when you were younger. Is that correct?
Yeah, Paul, you know what? He, you know, I got to know him. I sent him a letter when I was in high school, and we got to be, you know, good friends, and he sort of put me to work, you know, doing some research for him. I wrote a lot of his material, stuff that, you know, that we used to see a long time ago on SportsCenter, College Game Day, you know, all ESPN Radio, his chat online, things like that. And, you know, I didn't know it at the time, but he, you know, he wanted to write a book, and he was trying to put it together and just couldn't get the thing moving. He wasn't a sit down in front of a computer, typewriter, you know, notepad, what have you. Couldn't get it done. And turns out that was the big job. The biggest job he had assigned for me. You know, and I got it done.
John, what do you think Beano would say about everything that's going on in college athletics the last 12 months?
You know what? I think he'd probably hyperventilate a little bit. You'd get a lot of his unbelievables. You know, his catchphrase, his famous line. And then I think once he caught his breath, he would say, "I told you so." I think if you read this book that we put together, even though, you know, it'll be 10 years this October since he passed away, the guy had incredible foresight. It was like he had a crystal ball in his apartment in Pittsburgh. He saw a lot of this stuff coming, and I think that, you know, he even thought as soon as President Kennedy was assassinated in 1963 that college sports needed a commissioner, you know, a Roselle-type figure. And I think he saw all these things coming down the pipe, and that, you know, we would have to be dealing with them. But to be honest, I don't even know if he would come up with a lot of the NIL stuff or any of that.
What was that like for you when you first talked to Beano?
It was incredible. It was, you know, one of those deals where he gave me his home phone number. He wrote out a letter, you know, gave me his home phone number, told me a time to call. I gave him a few rings, you know, the phone just kept ringing and ringing. He had no answering machine. That was one of Beano's famous lines, you know, that if you call me and I don't answer, I'm either dead or I'm not home. Let's try again. And, but I finally got through to him, and the whole thing was, you know, I'm thinking it's going to be a, you know, professional question and answer session, or, you know, maybe a, you know, a mentorship type opportunity. He just dives right into life, tells me don't get married and all this other stuff. Yeah, it was a real eye opener. But man, I'm glad I did it. Probably the best thing I ever did in my life professionally was writing him a letter.
Can you give us? Paul's pretty good about voices of certain people. Can you give us one of his unbelievable?
Oh boy, I'm the wrong person. Tim Brando or Chris Fowler do the best impressions. But yeah, he'd be unbelievable. You know, one of those growly type. Things like that.
We'll have Brando on here pretty soon, and we have him on quite a bit, about once a month, and so we'll ask him that later on.
John,
he could probably do the whole show in Beano's voice.
John, Beano was so interesting to me in that he was, like you said, he had that crystal ball, but he could go 0 to 60 in his emotions so quickly about things, yet still be objective about it. How was he able to do that? Because you could tell what he's fired up about, but he wasn't In the way that we look at pundits now in sports, he wasn't a first take, a hot take guy. Everything was so well thought of, but he would go 0 to 60 pretty fast if he felt something pretty strongly.
Yeah, he sure did. And the real crazy thing about that is, if you knew him, he wasn't a big script guy. He wasn't a big, you know, I'm gonna hash this over and I'm gonna, you know, run it through my head 2 million times. He just kind of went. You know, he kind of turned on the computer, his mental data bank, whatever you want to call it, you know, pulled something out that he'd have a comparison to, whether it was World War II or, you know, whatever, and then go off from there. And it was crazy that how he would come up with this stuff, stay on target, but yet, he, you know, like you said, he kept his emotions in check. And I think, you know, unless you were dealing with Notre Dame, Penn State, the IRS, or the sport of baseball, you know, he could keep his emotions under control for the most part.
Who would you say is the modern day, and it's not even something that you would want to think there is one, but, you know, he was before Lee Corso, and we know what Corso's been for game day. Who is the modern day Beano Cook?
That's a really good question. You know, one of those, first thing when I wrote him that letter to go back a little bit, I told him I wanted to be, you know, the next Beano Cook or another. And he just said, don't even try. There's not going to be another one. You know, I guess you could say maybe Paul Feinbaum, he goes back, you know, he has that appreciation of, you know, the SEC and some sports for a long time. But I don't think there's anybody who has Beano's sort of his reach in terms of, you know, the national fandom of college football, plus the historical knowledge, plus that personality. I think that there's just, I really can't come up with anybody, to be honest. I think there's, he just had too much going for him. He had that voice. And like we mentioned in the book, that nickname, I mean, there's nobody else who really has a, you know, a catchy nickname like that. So that's final answer. I don't think there's anyone out there, to be honest.
Can you give us the background? I kind of hinted at that, but could you give us the background of the name of the book and where that came from?
Haven't they suffered enough? It's probably Beano's most famous line. He was at the NBA All-Star game 1981, being played right outside of Cleveland, and the word came over. This is, I think, before the game. You know, Beano and a bunch of other writers, sports writers and TV people. He was at the hotel before the NBA All-Star game, and I guess his job at the time, he was working for CBS. He was their head sports publicist, and somebody just asked him a question. One of the sports writers said, "Hey, Beano, did you hear the news?" He said, "What news?" He said, "The Iran hostages that were, 444 days were kept captive there. All the guys from our embassy after the Iranian Revolution, 1979, were finally being released. And when the word came out that all these people were coming home, these men and women, you know, Bowie Kuhn, the commissioner of baseball at the time, you know, it was a complete PR move, public relations gesture. He said that we're going to give all these returning hostages lifetime passes to Major League Baseball. Beano laughed. He said, right off the top of his head, haven't they suffered enough?
That's awesome.
And if you knew Beano's, his hatred or, you know, dislike of baseball, that line fit right with his personality. That was just the way he was. And again, there was no research. He didn't write a script. He didn't try that out on Benny. It just came right off his lips.
One of the other things about Beano Cook, a lot of times you just associate him with college football, but he was former ABC, CBS publicist, ABC and ESPN studio commentator, all that. But part of the book is a background with Pat Summerall, early on with Brent Musburger, among others, Jimmy the Greek Snyder. So he was very influential there as well.
Oh, definitely. You know, I mean, you hit the nail on the head. His name is synonymous with college football, but, you know, he had all these different jobs over the years. I mean, the whole book, it's about 400 pages because it's a 60-year career. He had all these different gigs, but he met so many famous, influential, infamous people. You can out Howard Cosell to that list, Phyllis George, a lot of these TV people, you know, and that's just the sort of, you know, the famous on-air names, the talent names we know. There's so many other stories in there about producers and directors and executives and, you know, people who are, you know, famous in the, you know, the media industry that that Beano's path crossed with. And he, you know, he has great interactions, and he took a phenomenal amount of notes in order to sort of get these stories down. And a lot of these things, I mean, if you people buy it, obviously it's a big college football book, big sports book, and it's a big sports history book. But there's so much behind the scenes, pulling that curtain back from, you know, I really think it was probably the golden years of network TV sports. You know, you talk about the 60s, 70s, 80s, Monday Night Football, you know, college football, all the, you know, famous names associated that Beano worked with there. There's, you know, you really get a good idea of a sort of an insider's perspective of what, you know, what sports was like, what the business was like. And, you know, Beano takes you back there. He takes you back in time.
He was the PR guy with the Miami Dolphins when Don Shula was there. Was he a part of that unbeaten team in 72?
No, you know what? He got there the year he was the PR guy, head publicist, the year they lost in the Sea of Hands playoff game. And had they advanced there, they would have moved forward, and it would have been, you know, for the third consecutive Super Bowl. So, and he didn't get along with Shula. As people were reading the book, he couldn't stand Shula. And there's a great line in there that he acknowledged how great of a coach Shula was. He said, but he was a dictator. He was there was no funny business with him. And he said, but the guy's a winner. He said, if I ever buy a professional football franchise or a concentration camp, I'd want Don Shula to run it. So, but it was funny that, that was the way it worked out. And Bino, to the day he died, he thought that Shula sort of carried a grudge with him because, coaches are extremely superstitious, and that, Bino was the one different puzzle piece, in those 3 years that he thought maybe the Dolphins, they would have, been the first NFL team to get 3 rings. And, he figured that Bino might have been the guy that ruined that for him. So who knows?
John, thank you for your time. Again, the book is called Haven't They Suffered Enough? Amazon, everywhere you want to go, you can Google it. I put it up on the link that has the interview with John, also on a couple of others when we prepared for this segment today. Thanks for your time. Good luck with it, okay?
Hey, thanks. Thanks for having me, guys. Keep up the good work.
John Lucas, again, author, Haven't They Suffered Enough? And the great personality who loved college football like no other in Beano Cook.